We welcome you to worship today. And as we do so, we acknowledge that Calvary United Church stands on Treaty 6 territory. We pay our respects to our elders, both past and present, wherever we find ourselves this morning. We recommit to our status as an affirming ministry within the United Church of Canada and strive to be an open-minded, inclusive, and welcoming place of worship. It is our deepest hope that all people might feel at home in this space, and we give thanks to God for this Sabbath day, where we join our hearts and minds in prayer.
Approach our Creator Christ Spirit. Gentle, comforting, sustaining, Holy Trinity, you continue to surprise us with the open tombs within our lives. Renew in us yet again that sense of the awesome mystery experienced by those who came to the tomb, only to discover that it was empty. Grant to us the leeway to have our doubts, just as Jesus' friends doubted when they heard the good news. Give us a sense of heartfelt joy comparable to the weary travelers who encountered Jesus on the road. Come with us as we follow in the footsteps of the generations before us, absorbing what it means to speak your truth throughout this Easter season. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Amen.
Holy One in Three,
In the heart of our Easter experiences, we embrace once again the stories of the disciples who experienced Jesus' presence amidst a cacophony of bewilderment, disbelief, and delight. We also experience a multitude of emotions as we try to make sense of this exceptional history. How do we explain that one who was crucified and then buried lived anew and moved again amongst those whom he loved? Forgive us, O God. Forgive us that we continue to find belief challenging, if not outright difficult. Forgive us that we continue to require the reassurance that this miracle truly happened. Forgive us that we continue to seek rational, logical explanations for that which truly is miraculous. Give us the strength to embrace that which is beyond our comprehension, but not outside of our capacity to believe, to make allowance for. See what our Creator Christ Spirit has given to us, that we should be called children of God. We are children of God, children of our Creator. What we will become remains unrevealed to us. Nevertheless, we do place our trust in this, that we will become fulfilled reflections of our Creator's light and love. Let our light then shine for others, and let us love, not in word alone, but in truth and in deeds. Amen.
In the Spirit, let us travel, open to each other's pain. Let our loves and fears unravel, celebrate the space we gain. There's a place for deepest dreaming, there's a time for heart to
The good news which flows out of our Easter weekend is that we have been richly blessed. In being thus blessed, we have received this unique opportunity to be a blessing to others. We share aloud the good news. Jesus lived, Jesus died, Jesus lives. In our celebration of this good news, we truly wish to express our gratitude in prayer, in thoughts, and also in our actions. May our offering this day be a reflection of our commitment to live within the grace of your love, O God, as a reminder to us that it is within our generosity that we live into the fullness of our faith. Amen. Even though we have eased some of our social distancing protocols, nevertheless, we continue to be careful. And so we offer to each other this morning the gift of peace by waving our hands to those who are sharing in this service with us, either in person or online. Let us greet those we see around us, and also those who will watch this service on the internet, with the gift of our Creator Christ Spirit's love and peace by waving our hands at a safe distance. Peace be with you.
The first scripture reading is from Acts chapter 5, verses 27 to 32. When they had brought them, they had them stand before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with the teachings, and you are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and the forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." Our gospel reading is from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. Hear what the scriptures are saying to the church.
May the thoughts that I share with you this day and the ways in which we integrate all of our thoughts within our respective and collective faith journeys be our gift to our Creator Christ Spirit. Amen. Today's readings from the Gospel of John and from the book of the Acts of the Apostles are significant within the history of Christianity, uniquely so because they give us glimpses into the transfiguration of the disciples from followers into leaders. Up until Holy Friday, Jesus had been the leader teacher. From Holy Friday to Easter Sunday, the disciples were somewhat lost, grieving, perhaps even angry, and probably wishing that they had the means to retaliate against the Hebrew leadership in Jerusalem, as well as against the Roman officials who carried out the death sentence that the Hebrew leadership demanded of them. What lit the spark that got the disciples all fired up? How did they move from grieving into taking ownership of their own abilities? The foundation of their renewed vigor can certainly be connected to the good news of Easter Sunday, with the cry from several sources, "He is risen." The women who were part of their group had already attested to this. However, in what I dare to say is a typical reaction, the men did not believe the women's tales. The men wanted proof. Proof did appear in two distinct forms. The first can be found in a familiar story in Luke's Gospel, which is not in this year's cycle of readings, but which we remember well. It speaks to us of an encounter with a so-called stranger who joined two grieving disciples on the road to Emmaus and whom they finally recognized when the stranger broke bread during their shared evening meal. The second was an appearance in the midst of the gathered group, where the disciples are invited to place their fingers in the holes made by the nails used for Jesus' crucifixion. Seeing in each of these instances definitely resulted in believing. The story of the two disciples on the road to Emmaus might have been dismissed as merely wishful hoping, but the gathered group being challenged to test the nail holes in the hands and feet ignites a whole new faith journey. We are the great, great beyond numbering grandchildren of the disciples who had these unique communal experiences. We are the heirs to the stories, the emotions, the resolve of a group of individuals, followers who were utterly convinced that they were part of something new and exciting on behalf of the human race. The belief that there is life after death and that our Creator Christ Spirit offers it freely from the pain of the cross and the wonder of the empty tomb. I do ponder, however, during each post-Easter season, this question. Are we even capable of comprehending just how astonishing this unique experience would have been for the disciples? How do we begin to understand how threatened the Jewish leadership group would have been by the theological challenge to their long-held religious worldview? Never mind the threat to that already fragile nature of their relationship with the Roman Empire's local governing elite. How do we, 2,000 years later, with all of the Christian theological movements that have wended their way within Christendom throughout the ages, how do we today reconnect with the disciples as they digest their experiences and interpret to others what they believe? I would suggest a few avenues of exploration. The first centers on the disciples themselves. They believed, period, full stop. The disciples could not have accomplished all that they were able to do in their post-Easter efforts had they, like Thomas initially, been hesitant or skeptical. That solid conviction comes through in their defense in front of the Sanhedrin. They knew what they were, and they stood up for it, and they would not be bullied into denying what they believed to be the truth. We would not be here today had they not stood up to those long-ago authorities, often in subsequent years at the cost of their own lives. We know that several, if not most, of the disciples were executed, Peter being the most notable in Rome, and then, of course, Paul, a post-Easter disciple, also in Rome. Many followers of Jesus lost their lives when they refused to deny that which they believed so strongly. That alone testifies to the strength of their faith. The other factor which helped the progress of Christianity as it grew into becoming a major world religion is that people were looking for something positive in which to place their faith. It is one thing to say be good and do good while you are alive. Most religions offer that as a basic foundation for the good health and well-being of a community. What made Christianity unique in its inception was the concept of a life beyond life, the belief that some part of us somehow exists beyond death. There are, I will acknowledge, echoes of this belief within the various Eastern religions. In the beginning of the Christian era, that belief was linked absolutely with a physical resurrection. Over the centuries, the concept of resurrection has been transformed into this ideal, the shaping of a spiritual continuity, best defined as being that which is rooted in the Holy Spirit within each of us, guiding each of us along our human journey in pathways of love and generosity, and ultimately seeing our uniquely individual spirit joining in the afterlife with the wider group of spirits. I would conclude today's reflections with this personal observation. At this moment in my own faith journey, I find myself quite willing to be surprised by the wherewithal of the afterlife. I am no longer the teenager who wants precise details. Given a lifetime of experiences, today I simply and humbly embrace the hope that some part of me, however ephemeral, will continue in community with some part of others. Meanwhile, the one thing I can continue to do is to live a faithful, loving life in the here and now of our shared faith journeys. I certainly make no claim to be perfect in this endeavor, but it remains the ideal which I use as my measuring rod, demanding of myself that I reflect on how my actions might aid the well-being of the wider community that remains our shared home in the here and now of our daily lives. I also continue to believe that my faith journey happens within community, and that it is a shared experience within our collective faith journeys as part of this congregation and beyond Calvary United Church as an integral part of the United Church of Canada, and even beyond that, as part of the faith journeys of others throughout the world, no matter how unique those faith journeys might be. Sometimes, though, I do wonder if I myself am on the road to Emmaus, lost and confused, and just hoping that someone will come along and have all the answers. At other times, I am in that room with the disciples looking at Jesus as he exposes the holes in his hands and his feet, knowing that he endured even this to prove the value of faith and of faithfulness. I conclude with this echo from the hymn, "In the Bulb There Is a Flower." What it is, a mystery, something God alone can see. It is a mystery. And with that affirmation ringing in my mind, I find myself quite content to offer my gratitude to our Creator, Christ Spirit. Thanks be to God. Amen.
From all your fear.
And now the pastoral prayer. Let us pray. May our Creator Christ's Spirit, light and love fill us with a willingness to contemplate our own life journeys as we offer this, our post-Easter prayer. Generous, loving Creator, you shape us to live with each other in communities. Today we give thanks for the richness of the experiences that have enlarged our lives and increased our joy. We hear stories reflecting the lives of our ancestors within the covers of the Bible, and we find ourselves engaged anew in faith-related questions. Again and again, we marvel at the ways in which human beings have transformed their personal experiences into celebrations of love. We applaud the ways in which their faith has embraced the fullness of life from day to day. So it is that we offer our gratitude for the ways in which we also have been touched by those around us, for the ways in which we have been able to discern what you require of us, and for the ways in which our focus remains turned toward the sacred in the midst of a secular world. We rejoice in the ongoing exploration of our Lenten experiences, trusting that each journey offers us a glimpse into the brightly woven tapestry that is your love for all creation. It seems right and fitting to absorb the strength we find in our faith in you and to use that strength to express a vision for life in the world as a whole. Be with us as we address the needs of our neighbors who endure challenges beyond our comprehension. We reflect especially on the people in the Ukraine whose lives have been devastated by a war not of their choosing. We reflect as well on the people of Russia who are suffering the consequences of decisions made by their isolated leaders. We reflect on our own neighbors who day in and day out offer a pattern of care that enhances our living within the relative safety of this community. We are a people, O God, in reality, who do remember. We remember the biblical stories that we have learned over the years, stories that inspire us and that help us to reflect on our own lives. We remember sermons we have heard and appreciated. We remember unexpected acts of kindness and of generosity. We offer our thanks for life and for love, for faith and for healing grace, for hope and for the courage to dream, combined with the will to transform dreams into reality. We thank you, O God, in the Lenten season for the grace we enjoy even as we dream of a world that would enjoy the blessings that fill our lives with peace and with hope. Within the context of our hope, we offer this prayer using words that are familiar and or comfortable to us. Our Creator Christ Spirit, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And we close with a blessing for this season. May the grace of our Creator, deeper than our imagination, the strength of the Christ, stronger than our need, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit, richer than our togetherness, may these divine qualities guide and sustain us now and always. May the Holy Trinity, who dances in creation, who embraces us with love, and who shakes our lives with the power of thunder, bless us and send us forth as Easter people to fill the world with justice, with peace, with hope, and with love. Amen.